Welcome back to KC Cares, Kansas City's nonprofit voice, brought to you by Charitable Communications and generously sponsored by the Kauffman Foundation. I am Bobby Keys.
And I'm Ruth Bombigas, and we are coming to you. We do not let coronavirus stop our program.
No, absolutely.
We go on.
Absolutely. We have to go on. And now I think it's needed more than ever. We have to get the news out to people of how they can get help, how they can move forward. And, you know, that's what we're doing.
You're doing it. And we have one of the best experts ever. We have doctors. Philanthropy back. We have Jeffrey Byrne, who is co-founder and CEO of Byrne Pelofsky and Associates. Hi, Jeffrey. You're back from continent far away.
Hi, Ruth. I came back to this mess that we call the coronavirus, but glad to be with Bobby and you, and glad to be back at work and helping put out some great information about what nonprofits should be thinking about and doing during this really, really unprecedented time we're in.
Well, we don't want to waste time with us talking. So, doctor, please, what should people be doing in this sphere of corona and fundraising? That seems like such an, you know, reverse type things that you would want to be doing. How can we fundraise at this time?
That's right. Well, I think that, Ruth, I think that this is a real important time for nonprofits to stay as close together with their donors and patrons as possible. We look back at three different recessions that have happened over the last 20 years. The recession after 9/11, the recession once the war started in 2003, and then, of course, the Great Recession in 2008 after the September meltdown of the fiscal markets. And while those were a fiscal issue, not a health related, some of the elements that we did during that time period are relevant today, stacked upon the health. You know, number one, what's different is obviously we're a stay at home community here in the greater Kansas City area. Mm-hmm. And all of us do need to stay at home and away from others as much as possible. However, some of the, and we will get through this health issue. And so I think the ideas of what we learned in the past are good today. Number one, I think organizations really should stay the course. There's no reason to cut back because of the federal government's CARES Act. And I can talk about that in a few minutes.
Yeah.
But, you know, I think that nonprofits should really, as much as possible, try to stay the course. You should engage authentically with your top donors, board development officers, and CEOs. And to me, that is probably one of the most important things that you do. You don't want to shy away. Number one, you want to find out how your donors are. You want to find out how their families are. And then you want to engage about what you're doing to keep your organization relevant in this period. Number two, you want to be optimistic. Don't be a Debbie Downer, for God's sake. Everyone's a Debbie Downer. So you need to paint a realistic and not Pollyannish view, but you need to provide a half glass full of what you're doing for the community through your organization. You got to creatively communicate with your donor base. And by that, I mean, you know, you don't only use email. You can use other types of technology like Zoom, like Skype, like Microsoft Teams. I cannot tell you how many Microsoft Teams, Zoom, and Skype meetings I have been a part of the last 10 days. Also, social media really works. Videos, talking about and telling your story. You know, fundraising is about storytelling, and this is the most of the important time you should be talking about your stories. For instance, we have a client who is Blue Valley Education Foundation. They recently sent out a video and some photos along with an update to their patrons in their foundation of teachers going by, waving at the kids from the street, the kids who have gone out on their driveways and put together chalk. help welcome and hello signs for their teachers, teachers who, families that have put a post and a sign in their yard for their teacher as he or she drives by. We have another organization that's been telling its story, which is MRI Global. And that is a national and international research body dealing with some of the nation's top secrets. Well, one of the things that they put together that has been used during the Ebola crisis and now during this coronavirus is a containment unit. And the containment unit can be utilized by individuals who need to be transported around the world. For instance, when the folks got off the ship in Asia during February and early March, they got onto a transportation unit that was designed by MRI Global.
Oh, okay.
So, you know, we've got great stories here in our backyard, and it's important that we tell those right now.
They basically gutted a big airplane and then redesigned it, right?
Now, it's not gutting a big airplane. It's literally a containment unit that can be inserted into one of the largest airplanes in the world.
Okay.
And it can fly around the world.
It looked huge.
It does. And, you know, to medically equip it, it's very expensive. But it's also the way technology is used. I mean, we learned, MRI Global learned a lot when they did that for Ebola. They will learn a lot this time during COVID virus for other viruses that come up in the future, even how to use containment and best practices in the future to even work on these diseases and viruses in a different way.
If I'm a nonprofit and I'm not healthcare related and I'm not direct service related, how do I deal with this in terms of, you know, your fundraising list? It just seems a little awkward, you know, if I'm doing something else to go out there and ask for money.
Well, I think that's a good question that all nonprofits should ask themselves. And it's just, you know, yes, health and human service organizations, Ruth and Bobby, are going to do better and have more access to individual, corporate, and foundation money, because that's where all of their priorities are being directed. That is like any fiscal or recessionary period we go through, especially during this time period. Organizations like animals, environment, the arts especially, have all shut down or have all scaled back as it relates to animals. So, you know, I think one of the areas that they should be concerned about and think about doing is the CARES Act. You know, this is a federal grant opportunity through the Small Business Administration. And this is part of what Congress passed last week and the president signed as part of the $2+ trillion response to really propping up our economy. It's not an economic recovery program as much as it is propping up the economy through direct assistance to businesses and individuals. For instance, the SBA has released what they call what we call the Economic Injury Disaster Loan. And these Economic Injury Disaster Loans can provide, once you apply for it, and any nonprofit can apply to this Economic Injury Disaster Loan. And what you do is, if you have under 500 employees, you can apply. What you do is automatically within 3 days, you get a $10,000 allotment that is deposited by the U.S. Treasury into your checking account. Now, you can use that any way you want. That does not have to be paid back, even if your loan is disapproved or if it's approved or you go through the Paycheck Protection Program as well. So I encourage all of our listeners, if they already haven't, to get go to the SBA or go to ByrnePelofsky.com, and we have on there some guidelines for the Economic Injury Disaster Loan. But I can tell you, any nonprofit that's not applying is rather foolish, because you automatically get a $10,000 grant. And it doesn't need to be repaid. The second area in the SBA program is called the Paycheck Protection Program. And this is what is available to nonprofits as long as you don't reduce your payroll or you don't reduce your pay cuts over 25% per employee, you can apply for a full loan based on a formula that you will need to work with an SBA provider or your own banker. And you can then protect your workers and their salaries and also pay your mortgage, pay your rent, or pay your utilities over an 8-week period through this. And if you do that, you can then, it is refundable. The government will allow you to, they'll give you that money for free. Once you have done that, you follow their guidelines and you then report back how you use the money. The government will then let that loan become zero. So they will forgive the loan. So there are some really great opportunities in the CARES Act, C-A-R-E-S Act. And once again, if you go to ByrnePelofsky.com or KC Cares website, you can find out information on these opportunities.
You also have mentioned, and we'll post this information too for our listeners, that you've got 6 steps to successful solicitation. I love that alliteration. Are there some things just really quickly that you could share for us folks? You know, what, you know, it sounds like you're saying don't necessarily be afraid to ask for support. So how do you ask?
Oh, you know, don't be afraid to ask for support. Number one, you got to tell your story. So get your story together, get it in writing and be able to articulate it to your donor, whether you're going to write them an appeal via email or probably email right now because direct mail is even, you know, people aren't really checking direct mail. So get your story together, get your list together, prioritize it. Segment it. I'm all into, as I've said over the years on your program, I'm all into donor segmentation. Don't send out a general email. Send out an email or make appeals by phone to a segmentation of your list. Take your top 25 donors, handle them individually via email and phone and text. Take another group of your donors and then send out a more general email asking for general support. Make sure your front door during this time period is attractive and addresses the issues that you are dealing with. And that front door is your website. So those are some of the areas, I think, in the 6 criteria for success or best practices that you would want to concentrate on during this time.
Play forecaster for us. You know, let's say we've gotten through this, please God, in a sooner rather than later fashion. How do you think the fundraising landscape will change?
Well, I think that we're going to see a really heavy toll on giving this year. You know, giving went down for the Great Recession some 14% over a 6-month period. And that was the largest drop in giving in recorded history. I'm not sure if this is going to be that type of situation, but we're going to all have to regroup. Every organization is going to have to regroup. They're going to have to, you know, really work with their board of directors that all nonprofits would have. They're going to have to think about being creative. We can't go all to the same 20 funders in Greater Kansas City and expect all of us to get funded by them. So we're going to have to be creative. Number three, we're going to have to give our donors a little breathing time to get themselves back into a position where they feel like they want to support. They can fiscally do it in a responsible way. So, I mean, you've got to put your mindset in the mind of your donor as well, and think about his or her position, and not be over demanding, but be considerate and work with them. Foundations are going to have seen their assets drop. Companies are going to see their revenues down. So we're going to have to all pitch in together and rely on each other. I mean, find out what your colleagues are doing in the nonprofit community. I've reached out this week to some of my consulting other consultants in the nationally to find out how they're working with their nonprofits on this. this is the time that we need to be, we need to increase and enlarge our family more than ever so that we're getting good information from each other and that we can share that good information.
Jeffrey, Dr. Philanthropy, as always.
Hey, thanks a lot, Bobby. Thanks a lot, Ruth. And I wish all the nonprofit communities success and just give it time. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.